Okay, I think we can get started. Why not? Let's be just in time. I see few people coming in now, so I guess we are all good to go. So this session has been recorded, and welcome everybody. My name is Stefano Tempesta. I'm here together with my other co-organizer, Alessandro Graps, and we welcome you to this first meetup, virtual meetup, given the circumstances around robotics and artificial intelligence. Why did we create this meetup? There are so many meetups, there are so many events that are happening online, but we thought we want to introduce something that is closer to the industry 4.0. So the new connected and AI power industry. So we, in the next months, are going to cover a number of events. We have a sort of prepare a calendar of events that goes from computer vision, smart city, the industrial Internet of Things, and then some ideas for next year's. And we have many more ideas that we want to share with the community. The agenda is flexible. Something new and trendy can come in the next months, and we may want to prioritize. Your feedback is appreciated as well, so we can also add the new content depending on a specific demand. But this is sort of what we are planning to do in the next 6 months. And as I said, more and more will come. We are thinking about drones, we are thinking about something related to security, predictive maintenance, even quantum computing. So we'll see as it goes, as this community grows. A quick introductions. With me, I have Alessandro. Alessandro is the CEO of Julab. He's based in Switzerland. He's going to introduce himself in a moment. And I'm Stefano Tempesta. I'm CTO at Connecting Software, Microsoft Regional Director and MVP. And indeed, I am based in Australia. Although I'm originally from Italy, I lived in Switzerland for a couple of years. Now I'm in Melbourne. So today is all about computer vision. And specifically, we want to share a couple of experiences. One that Alessandro and his company have been doing in the mining industry, digital transformation in the mining industry with a specific focus on developing a helmet, a smart helmet, a helmet that is connected and provide insights and telemetry to the technicians that use it. And then I will be presenting a new little toy called Azure Kinect, which is something that Microsoft has launched a device a few months ago. It's based on years and years of experience in the gaming industry. You may be familiar with Kinect coming from the Xbox environment or device if you have used it before. And now this device has been re-engineered into something that doesn't target gaming and homes any longer, but is more for the industry, more for large scale automation. So you're gonna hear a bit more about it in a moment. But before anything else, some rules of the house. You're welcome to ask questions anytime. Just write in the chat or unmute yourself. And we'll give the attention. And this session is recorded, as said, so we'll be publishing on YouTube channel. We are still organizing a few things. This is the first meetup, so forgive us if we are not perfect. We're trying our best. And with no further hesitation, I leave it now to Alessandro Graps to introduce himself, introduce the community in Switzerland where he's based, and share some insight about digital transformation in the mining industry. Alessandro, if you're there, please go ahead.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much, Stefano, for your perfect introduction. And first of all, I would like to explain why we decided to create another meetup. There are a lot of meetup about artificial intelligence, robotic, machine learning, etc., etc. But we think to create a community here in Switzerland. I know Stefano is based in Australia, but as I said, he lived in Switzerland for a couple of years, and sometimes he is here in Switzerland to follow with us some shared project. And we decided to create a community related with machine learning, robotic, digital transformation, where we can grow, we can share our real case, we can understand who are the people in Switzerland that work with this kind of technology. That's why we decided to create this meetup. That's our first meetup. I hope it will be perfect, but we are human. We are not robots, and maybe there are something to calibrate better. Okay, I started to share my screen with the first presentation. Okay. Yeah. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, all good.
Thank you very much. Okay, today I would like to talk about our real case. A smart helmet that we created for mining industry. Before a small presentation, I am Alessandro Graps. I'm based in Lucerne, Switzerland. I am a CEO of Julab Group. Julab is a company, is an R&D company specializing in digital transformation, electronic, mechanic, and robotic. We work in a different in different sectors like automotive, packaging, avio, energy, defense, and et cetera, et cetera. We base in Switzerland, but we have other three offices, two in Italy, in Bologna, in Taranto, and one in Melbourne, in Australia. And that's why we created this project, because Australia was is a country with where mining is the first economy, and for one big mining customer created this prototype. It's a smart helmet. That is our project. This project is dividing two parts. The first part is a helmet to create for safety of employee and the technician inside the mine. The second part is related with machine learning, all cognitive system related with vision to understand and to predict what kind of mineral and what kind of stuff we can find inside our mine. That is the real helmet. It's our first prototype. We create this helmet, as I said, to assure more safety for the employee We create to detecting bad air, temperature, humidity, heart rate, CO2, collision. We added a different sensor inside this helmet, and we use this helmet to understand what the employees see during the job. That is our small process. There are a lot of sensors inside. We use Microsoft technology Azure Azure where we configure IoT Hub to get the data. Microsoft Dynamics 365 and field services to manage information from sensor and for safety employee, and Power BI to have a real-time dashboard with all to monitoring the technician and employee. That is the diagram. We can see IoT Hub, where we get information from different sensors and we get images. The information from sensor are moving stream analytics processing and send to machine learning for business intelligence, and or to send in Dynamics 365 as a IoT alert, or in real time in Power BI for monitoring with a dashboard. The images are stored in a blob and send in a match classify, where with the cognitive system and machine learning are analyzing to get information about the material that we can see. The project, the architecture is divided in five parts. The first part is related with event. Event for us are all sensors. The second part is related with the collection, all the real gateway to get this information. IoT platform, as I said, is all we use Microsoft Azure IoT, IoT Hub, Microsoft Azure Stream Analytics, and Microsoft Azure Machine Learning. Action, where all information are sent as IoT alert in Dynamics 365, and processes with a small machine learning to analyze the life value from employee. And of course, all part related or image, where we analyze and study what the probability to see, for example, gold and amber, because we are working with these two kind of mining industry. And the presentation. Presentation is related with Power BI. As I said, collection, IoT platform, all our IoT platform. Action. And the part of presentation, where we are all telemetry for live dashboard, time series inside, and we can browse all historical telemetry part. That is what we created inside Azure. We can see all cognitive system services to connect with Azure and image classify, all storage account, logic app for the Dynamics 365 Power BI, and when we receive information from our sensor, we create a custom query inside the stream where we can get only the real and important information to send or to Dynamics 365 or Power BI. That is the IoT container that we where we storage all images from our cam, because I'm missing an information inside the on the helmet. There is a small cam that every 30 seconds make a picture and send in on IoT hub from Azure. All of this information are sent or can you see my screen? Sorry.
No, Alessandro, I think we lost it. Can you try again, please?
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, that's better. Carry on.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. I don't know why, but I lost the connection, the connection with my screen. And as I said, these container, these images are sent in image classifier, in Azure Image Classifier. We configure the image classifier to add different training images where the machine learning or the intelligence can understand what they want. There are different material: gold, amber, and quartz. Why quartz? Because in a gold sector, you can understand if there are gold inside the earth or in the stone, if you can find quartz and carbon, because that's are the two material that gave me this information. And we add a lot of real imaging to training our engine. The second part is to create a training model when we adding the imaging inside the imaging classify. We need to start the training and to create all process to analyze and then test the image. That is the result that we have. We have three main information. The precision is the percentage of the classification that were correct. If my model identify, for example, 100 images to be hills, and only 19 of these images were actually hills, it will have a precision of 90%. Recall is the percentage of actual classification that were correct, and AP is an overall measure of the model's performance. It averages the precision of the model over different probability threshold. That is a part of important part inside our firmware, because you can see inside two part. The first part is related with send image to the blog, because we need to send image inside our blob. The second part is the get status for when we send images. Because when we use image classify related with IoT, we always create a connection inside our Azure platform between blob and between image classify. And we created all cognitive system. That is the part for upload the specific file inside the blob and to get the result. And what we come back, return back? The return back, that's the probability, when we get send an images, we get a probability of, for example, that this image is rated for amber or gold. What we tagged, and all information related about probability and precision of our engine. As I said, there are also a part related of live monitoring, where we send all IoT alert inside the Dynamics 365, where all information for the sensor. That's an example for one sensor information where we have a temperature, humidity, GPS, because we need where the employee is in status, if there are dangerous situation. And that is our monitoring. We can see the helmet. Each helmet has a unique identifier code. There are information, there are the air quality, current air quality. And of course, we have also the information about the GPS. What we are doing now, we are creating our smart glasses to give a real information, not only to the central monitor, but also directly to the employee that use this helmet. I hope that in the next few months, we can give the first release for these helmets. Finish. Question about this topic?
Alessandro, there are a few questions in the chat, if you can read them.
Yes, wait a second. I have to open the chat. Just give me 1 second. Okay. Where is the chat? Chat here. Sorry. Why 30 seconds between capture imagings? Why we were giving long gap? Because it's a request from our customer. Because we get an image. Every 1 second, but for the this kind of project, it's enough to have not a real images, but every 30 seconds is a good gap for this image. What happening where things find long gap? Depend on what kind of project do you are you following? Because if of course, if you are in medical surgery, according to me, you need to have a short gap. But if you are talking about a material, or what you can see during your technician, because you need information when you move your hands. According to me, 30 seconds is enough. Okay, the other good question. It's also interesting to have a VID of the last 30 seconds, so you could actually see more in case of an incident. Yes, of course, but this part of this part of the project is related to related with incident, but related to predict the material inside the mine. And yeah, for the incident, it's better to have a short gap with a lot of information. But for predict material in mining, we study that 30 seconds is a good gap to have. I think to answer all questions, Stefano, or there are other questions? Because...
No, that's what I see in the chat. Okay. So unless there are any other questions, I would say thank you, Alessandro, for the presentation. And
thank you.
So, yeah. I carry on now with my own presentation. And so for today, Alessandro and I have presented and prepared some content. They invite for the near future, for the next event, is for the community to give more contribution. And we are also working with a few industry experts, so we can bring also some expertise from different sectors to share their knowledge, their know-how with this community as well, especially starting from next month, where we talk about smart city. We'll be bringing more international experiences and, you know, add value to this community with more contributions. But if there is anybody out there in this community, in this audience, that has a particular interest in sharing some experiences, please feel free to do so and reach out either to me or to Alessandro, and we can make sure that you also have the possibility to present some topics. But let's carry on. And
sorry, Stefano. About,
Azure Kinect now. Okay, I got the device with me. So the device is here. And let me first introduce a bit, a few concepts around what is it, why Microsoft has decided to come out with a very powerful web camera, but it's really more than a web camera. And then we'll try to see something in action, okay? So first of all, what is Azure Kinect? As I mentioned at the beginning, Microsoft has an experience of a Kinect device in the gaming space from Xbox, but then it started adding more and more capabilities to position this device in the industrial sector. With a few examples, is a spatial computing device with sensors for capturing, obviously, color, camera, motion, body tracking, depth, and infrared, accelerometer, and sound, as obviously, as well. It comes with a software development kit, currently available only in C++ and C#, but I expect the more programming languages to be supported in the near future. And it comes with integration with the Azure Cognitive Services, which I'm going to show you a very brief example in a moment related to computer vision. A few areas or use cases where this device has been used in manufacturing to deliver an improved safety and performance. You can use the device for advanced body tracking, for example, to monitor and analyze the movement behaviors of workers. This can be benefit for designing a safer, more ergonomic workstation so that can mitigate long-term injury risk. At the same time, also improving productivity through task analysis and process optimization. So this has been paired with real-time depth sensors data with cognitive services, and using the power of AI to identifying anomalies in real time and help line workers to adjust to the environment in a factory. It's been used also in manufacturing to use to automate the process of loading and unloading, for example, streamlining repetitive tasks, such as stripping down a pallet to improve productivity, at the same time optimizing storage space in different smart ways, mobilize robot workers with spatial data, and automate new tasks by bringing robots into human spaces so they can collaborate together without bumping into each other. And also automate robots to work to be controlled remotely. And we'll be having a session in the future more about robots in the industry, and there is a significant experiences that that we will be able to share with the community. What else? Retail is another use case, using dimensional analysis to maximize transport storage space and optimize delivery logistics, move from predefined delivery routes to real-time routes based on inventory analysis and subsequent last mile efficiency. So this has created a connected retail experience, mapping and monitoring retail stores in real time. I've seen also an application in media entertainment to adding computer vision, speech capabilities to enhance the experience, for example, in sport activity, transform all these signals that we receive from sport events into interactive, personalized kiosk in some way that can enhance brand engagement. And the device provides depth sensors to capture high quality volumetric video that can be used in interactive 3D environments. And obviously associate this with augmented reality, virtual reality devices that you can also wear. And the device does a full body tracking, as we will see in a moment. And one of the last applications, one of the last use cases is in health or fitness. So again, using computer vision to track and monitor exercise movements and overall activity, body activity, and create a smart gym experience that can enhance results or be more inclusive, more accessible by those who cannot leave home and they are in a rehabilitation scenario, and they can benefit of this possibility to exercise and be monitored also remotely. Okay, so what's inside here? I'm not gonna open it, okay? But you can see the picture. There are different sensors. There is a color camera, which is this large one here, RGB camera, 12 megapixel. There is a depth camera, which is a passive IR infrared mode. And there is also a little one that is a narrow field of view depth mode. And we'll see this in action. One captures distance in a color map, and another one with highlighting in black and white. There is a motion sensor, a gyroscope, and an accelerometer. And there are seven mics, spatial mics, that can capture the data from all around the environment. It doesn't have speakers though, so it doesn't talk, listen, but it doesn't talk. So you need to connect. There is a possibility to connect from behind to an external device, and there is the possibility to connect multiple devices, multiple Kinect in a chain. It goes after the brand Azure Kinect DK, which doesn't stand for Denmark, but it stands for development kit. And because it comes with a tight integration with Azure Cognitive Services, specifically speech service for voice recognition, vision service for object detection and face detection. I'll show you that in a moment. And body tracking for body tracking. So for us, identifying movement or different joints in your body. So very briefly, the color camera, RGB camera, in connection with cognitive services can provide image classification, where you identify inside an image what is in the in that image, what the image is all about, or object detection, which identifies a different object inside a larger image. So think of you taking a picture of a desk, and on your desk, there is your laptop, there is your screen, there is your microphone, and so on. Image classification will tell you that is a desk. And object detection will go more into the details and say, okay, that is a desk, and there is a laptop, and there is a screen, and there is a mouse. And it will tell you also the coordinates of the object inside the image. And also text extraction, which is the traditional OCR, so identify text inside an image. It can do also face recognition, and these two are all services available in the Azure cloud. I'm going to show you that in a moment. For a face detection, so identifying a face inside an image, identify the face. So if that face is being pre-classified and labeled, so a name has been assigned to that face, then the API, that's the cognitive service, can do also a face matching and identifying that person. Let me show you a quick demo, how that looks like, just to have an idea how these services work. So I'm gonna launch this in the browser in a moment, and it's opening here. And I have a quick demo of different services, and I'm going to focus on the face detection here. First of all, you need to create this service in the Azure portal. So I'm going to go into the Azure portal and create the face service, which really takes less than a minute if you do it very quickly. So just go into your create resource, search for face. The first service comes out. Create a face, which you see is a facial recognition for no machine learning experiences required. And just create. And what happens is that you publish an API that is can be consumed over REST, over HTTP. So these there are different locations where you can provision the API. Consider the location that is closer to your business. Give it a name, a resource group, and a sponsorship, and a subscription, and then you're all done. I'm not gonna create yet another one because I have so many. So I'm gonna open the one that I have already created for myself. At the end, it really takes a minute to provision a face service in Azure. What you need is to grab a key and the endpoint. And with this combination of key and endpoint, you can start developing your application. And you can do it in multiple programming languages. You can do it C#, JavaScript, actually any programming language that can do an HTTP request to this endpoint and then read a JSON message in output. So I have created a demo environment here with some images that have been pre-categorized. And then I can upload some new pictures, or I can detect new pictures. So let's say I want to detect faces in these pictures here. So I'm going to select these. And as you can see down here, The result is some coordinates for picture one and picture two, which identifies the position of the face inside the image. And then some attributes of that face. We have a gender, age, smile, and some attributes here with values between 0 and 1 to identify also emotions. So it is possible to identify some feelings, some emotions for the specific face. Obviously it works in real time through the camera. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna stop my video here in Zoom, so not to create a conflict, and start taking the video here. And that's the camera. And we take a beautiful photo here. All right, so let's see what happens. And confirming here, and face identified, male, 48, quite right, not properly. And a few other things. It looks like I'm happy more than anything else, or a little bit surprised, and identify that they have some reading glasses. And the other thing is that you can do also face matching. Obviously, I'm not any of these celebrities here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take a photo here, you see? And I'm gonna go and search for our friends, Harry. I'm gonna get an image. And let's see, some image where he is here, nice and smiling. Okay, Harry, here you go. All right, where are you? And take a photo. None. Okay, it's a bit blurred, but that's okay. Hopefully it will come out. So face here detected, the male, age, blah, blah, blah. But find a match, and if this face is in any of these pictures here, it will be identified up there. So I'm gonna find a match, and boom, it comes out here as being recognized, okay? So, I mean, this is, you don't need Azure Kinect for that. You need any camera. But this is the power of the Face API that can do this recognition in a very quick way. And it really takes a few lines of code to do this detection. There's a question in the chat, which you see, is emotion binary or real number? And you got the answer yourself, is a real number. So it is the real number between 0 and 1. 0 meaning no emotion detected at all, and 100% of confidence that this that emotion. So anything in between, between 0 and 1. Okay, moving along, depth camera. What the device does pretty much is implement, okay, now I need to read this because this is complicated, is amplitude, modulated continuous wave, time of flight principle. Now, some of you out there knows what this is all about. I'm an engineer that develops software, so for me, it doesn't mean too much. But what I know is that the camera casts modulated illumination in the near infrared spectrum into the scene, and it then records an indirect measurement of the time it takes the light to travel from the camera to the scene and back. Then these measurements are processed to generate a depth map, and a depth map is a set of coordinate values for every pixel of the image measure in millimeters. And along with a depth map, the camera also obtain a clean IR infrared reading, and the value of pixel in this reading is proportional to the amount of light returned from the scene. So this is why a closer object is lighter, as you see the white back of the chair, and the other one are darker and are a bit on the back, okay? And then the things that I love a lot is the body tracking. Okay, so body tracking basically identifies multiple joints in a body. I don't know, for some reason, this guy here looks like Satya Nadella from Microsoft. Maybe they use it as a model. And it tracks every joint in three coordinates, X, Y, Z, and multiple joints in the body that you can see. So the position and orientation of each joint is mapped in a 3D coordinate system. And then the skeleton of the person has, let me start the video again. And the skeleton of the person has 32 joints that are all tracked. So when you track these, when you get this from the camera, you get automatically all the coordinates of the joints, joint by joint, and then you can decide whatever you wanna do. So what I'm gonna do now is showing this application in action. So rather than doing in a screenshot, let me go and grab this. Let's hope that it works without giving me any trouble. 1 second. So I have an SDK. There is a viewer here. Here we go. The viewer has started, and then I need to activate. 1 second. Get out of the screen. So the device is connected. Each device is identified by a serial number. I can connect multiple devices, and I can open the device. When I open the device, let's see, you get some information around the device itself. Let me go full screen here. Here we go. Resolution, frame per second. I can enable color camera, enable depth camera, enable the different sensors, enable the microphone. You know, so I can decide a few parameters on the camera, and then I can start. And here we are. We are live from my messy room in Melbourne. Hello, everybody. And then you can see on the left, right hand, the near IR, the infrared, the clean IR with the white and black. So white is closer and black is a bit more distance here. You see how we change colors depending on the distance, on the depth. And then on the right hand side, the depth map in color pixels, where again, each pixel is a different color, defines the distance. And then you get obviously the normal camera in there. And then you see on the bottom right, accelerometer, XYZ, the gyroscope, and also the mic. Mic, okay, I'm not using that mic now. So you see it's all flat. I'm using the other mic from my laptop, so you don't get the sound in there, but you see the accelerometer. So let me try to shake it a bit. Like, it's not me moving, it's the camera. Okay, so you see how the accelerometer is identifying it. If I do it left and right, it goes like this. Or if I do with a gyroscope, turn, flip around, rotate. Okay, I know you guys are getting sick now. And but it, just to give you the idea of how the accelerometer just react to movement. And obviously all this information is accessible through, so stop here, is all this information is accessible through through the SDK. And you can use C++. Or in C sharp to program the device, get this information in real time. And it's actually pretty easy to do it in C++ and also in C sharp. So I'll show you very quickly because in the interest of time, I want to arrive, I want to give some time for some questions at the end. But very quickly, what you have to do, my project is opening, I'm gonna show, here we go. There is a new get package. I've done this in C#, but you can do it in C++ as well, whatever is your preference. All you have to do is basically add these two new guest packages, Microsoft.Azure.Kinect.Sensor for the cameras and the sensors, and .BodyTracking for the body tracking, obviously. And then you start programming in C#. So what you do is basically use this namespace here, the Microsoft Azure Kinect Sensor, and then you have a device object. The device object is a static object. You open the camera. In this case, I'm just hard coding to open the one camera that I have, index 0, obviously. But if I had the multiple cameras, the get install count method will return how many cameras are available. And then I open camera 0, camera 1, camera 2, camera 3, and so on. Get some information about the firmware, like version number, serial number, version of the camera, the depth sensors, and so on. And then I start the camera. When I start the camera, I decide the attributes of the camera. For example, how many frames per second, and the values that is supported, it should come here in the list in a moment, is 5, 15, or 30 frames per second, different image format, resolution. So this is a very high resolution that I'm using at the moment. So you can get the traditional HD, which is 1920 by 1080, but in this case I'm going super high to 4096 by 3072. Okay, so you get progressive as well. So I'm getting ultra HD, whatever that means. And after that, you start the camera, and the camera gets all the values in as all the values as a capture. So this is my capture image or my capture of the sensors. And inside the sensors, I have all the attributes for the accelerometer, for the gyroscope. And inside the camera, inside the capture, I have all the information about the image. And this is, as you can see, is a cameras. So it's capturing an image that contains the RGB, but also the infrared, and it's all inside this object. At the end, don't forget to stop your cameras and to stop your measuring unit. This is what IBU stands for, so that which are the sensors, so that it can stop the device from using. So it's not difficult, it's just a few lines of code. What is what you have to do then, obviously, is to use this information for building your own application and whatever you want to do with it. So to get started, the URL on screen is the one that where you can get more information about the Kinect DK, which is available in several countries around the world, but not everywhere. So depending on where you are, you may get or may not get this available. Actually, you know what? Let's go and check. Let's go and check. Is this in the FAQ? Here we go. So it's currently available in the US, China, Germany, Japan, and the United Kingdom. Okay, so these are the countries where you can buy. Obviously, you can buy and ship it somewhere else, as I did, as I'm based in Australia. But you know, you can buy from the stores, from the Microsoft stores in this country. And then there are two GitHub repositories. The first one that contains the sensors SDK, everything is open source. So this is the beauty about it. So you buy the device, and then you can use the open source SDK, the open source SDK for the sensors and the cameras and for the body tracking. And then there is another one you see on screen here also for a lot of examples in C, C++, and C#, that you can use freely to start building your application. And that's it, really. That's all I wanted to share with you today. So thank you very much. Are there any questions about Kinect or about this user group or anything else that we can help you with?
Or as I said, Stefano, if you have some topic to share with the member of the community, you can share without any problem. For example, today, now I receive from new connection during a meetup, a new topic to use to create for the maybe the next event. He asked me to create an event about logistics and machine learning, and yes, why not?
Exactly. All right, so thank you very much. Thanks for coming to this first event. First of many, we're gonna see you next time on the 19th of November. And exactly, we have a good number of experts sharing their experience on the future of a smart city. Thanks very much. And thank you. See you next time.
Bye. Tschüss.